stop me, 'cause I'm having a good time, having a good time. I'm a shooting star leaping through the sky like a tiger, defying the laws of gravity. I'm a racing car passing by like Lady Godiva. I'm gonna go, 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 there's no stopping me. I'm burning through the sky, yeah. 200 degrees, that's why they call me Mr. Fahrenheit. I'm traveling at the speed of light. I wanna make a supersonic man.
You can hear 2 seconds of Queen song, you know exactly who it is. It's such a distinctive sound.
The way he connected with that stadium, those thousands and thousands of people, I've never seen anything like it.
Many bands have kind of tried and failed to become the best stadium rock band of all time, but I don't think anybody comes close to Queen.
Freddie Mercury was born Farrokh Bulsara in British colonial Zanzibar. At the age of 8, he was sent to St. Peter's boarding school in Bombay, where he formed his first band, The Hectics, who covered Little Richard's songs. It was here that his friends began to call him Freddie.
He was in a band called The Hectics, and he was the keyboard player, and there are pictures, sepia pictures of him looking very much like Little Richard with the brill creamed hair, and in a sense his piano style, which was very untrained. He put his hands hanging off the edge of the keyboard. He never learned how to pick them up properly. Extremely bold, extremely instinctive player, and I think you can see a lot of the Little Richard kind of playing in that, the early rock and roll influences.
Little Richard did play a key influence in Freddie's musical heritage. He also took inspiration from an artist much closer to home.
Freddie Mercury was a man who was influenced by many, many singers. When he was a kid in Bombay, he went to see Lata Mangeshkar, who was an Indian Bollywood playback singer. And she wasn't flamboyant at all, but she did have a remarkable vocal range. And that was the first thing which energised Freddie Mercury into singing. He was always unlike anyone else.
Freddie Mercury drew from a huge range of influences in terms of the people he was into. Lata Mangeshkar, the Bollywood singer, was a huge influence on him, and I think that probably influenced his actual vocal style. He was a creative fireball of energy, and he was really influenced by the kind of camp, I think, of Liza Minnelli, and the flamboyance as well of Little Richard, and the energy of his performance. So put all those things together and you've got kind of an explosive kind of combination.
The Zanzibar Revolution of 1964 meant Freddie's family fled the country for the UK. He began studying at Ealing Art College near his home in Feltham, London. The city had been blown away by the arrival of Jimi Hendrix, and Freddie too had fallen under his spell.
The person that Mercury was truly in love with, which people often forget, was Hendrix. So it wasn't just the usual interest that a young man of that age had in Hendrix. He was a great guitar player. There was something about him that fascinated him. His early sketchbooks from Ealing Art College and his folders were covered in these beautiful pictures that he'd done of Hendrix. And you can see the mannerisms of Hendrix way into his live career himself. The way that Hendrix would kind of drool over his guitar and bend over it is exactly what Freddie Mercury did with his little signature sawn-off microphone stand.
Anyone who was around that time was influenced by Jimi Hendrix, because he just took things to another level. Some of the blues musicians in London were very serious, and Jimi Hendrix just kind of came along and set things on fire and just went absolutely all out to entertain people and to grab people's attention.
Even in something like the tour jacket from their last ever tour, the little military jacket that he wore in 1986, that's kind of Hendrix's military thing 10 years later. So I think that was somebody that he never quite shook off, and he had a very, very, very strong feeling for Hendrix.
After a string of unsuccessful ventures, Freddie joined the band Smile, who were formed of guitarist Brian May and drummer Roger Taylor, but were missing a singer. Freddie convinced the band to take on the new name of Queen, and with the 1971 inclusion of bassist John Deacon, they began working together.
Queen were unusual in that they were 4 competing songwriters, and they all wrote hit singles individually. Now, Freddie Mercury was unquestionably a great frontman, but Queen were much more a collaborative democracy. Brian May, he's a man with a stubborn determination. He was nobody's sideman. John Deacon, the man who refuses to join the reinvigorated Queen, he's a man with a mind on its own. Roger Taylor, he's a drummer capable of writing hit singles. No one's going to shove him aside. It wasn't Freddie Mercury's band. It was a democracy.
Freddie used his time at Ealing to design a logo for the band. The crest is made of the zodiac signs of the whole group. Two Leo lions for John Deacon and Roger Taylor, a cancer crab for Brian May, and two fairies to represent Freddie's Virgo sign. Brian May created his own guitar for the band, known as the Red Special.
Like any band that started when they did in their early 20s, they showed an awful lot of influences of huge bands from the time. So I think there's loads of Led Zeppelin there and these great big drawn-out bluesy guitar riffs. And in fact, at the Freddie Mercury tribute concert, they put one of their own songs, Innuendo, together with Kashmir just to show how similar it was, and Robert Plant sang it, so there was like an acknowledgement of that influence.
Queen were influenced by a huge kind of variety of their kind of peers at the time. I think they were really influenced by the flamboyance of Bowie, the kind of heaviness of the Who. Also the experimentation, I'd say, of Pink Floyd, the heaviness of Led Zeppelin as well, and then the beautiful melodies of the Beatles. So you could argue actually they were a summation of all of those bands, really, with a little twist.
Queen were not without influences. They were certainly influenced by the glam stylings of, say, Cockney Rebel and Sparks, and they had a rock undertone that the British rock bands such as Led Zeppelin had. But because they were composed of four disparate personalities, they arrived almost fully formed. As individuals, they each had their own influences, and these brought together to make Queen fully formed from almost the day one.
The new band wrote two self-titled albums in the early 70s that initially didn't threaten the top of the charts, but slowly gathered an audience.
Queen 1 and Queen 2 weren't hugely successful at the time, but I think ultimately they were really important in forging the band that Queen were going to become. Certainly, they were kind of prog and heavy metal, like classics. I think people look back on them now and realise that, but at the time it seemed like they were just not right. They weren't right for the time, but it's one of those things where you look back on it and you realise how influential those records actually were.
The first Queen album, Rye, which is a sort of magical land which from which comes Seven Seas of Rye. So there's this quite kind of proggy, quite Tolkien-y, which is very much of the time.
Queen 1 was very much Queen finding their way, as it tends to be with debut albums, but it started with Keep Yourself Alive. What a way to begin a career. This blistering, all-out rock anthem, which today still sounds fantastic.
They're good albums. They represent young guys in that period and what they did, wearing their vintage clothing, going to the National Gallery to stare at paintings called things like The Fairy Fella's Masterstroke, and turn these literary and artistic ideas into songs, exactly the same way that you'd imagine students at that age were doing. So they're very typical. There's lots of overdubs. They are elaborate records, impossible to reproduce on stage in a lot of ways. John Anderson's very soft, very sweet, sugary vocal was kind of basically what Freddie Mercury was doing on the first two or three albums. And obviously they were hugely important for Brian May's melodic guitar sound as well. So I think there's a lot of Yes, which is very typical from that period.
Despite Seven Seas of Rye giving the band their first top 10 hit, the music press weren't fully won over.
Queen, from the start, were not critics' favourites by any means. I mean, the NME in particular was not huge fans of Queen, and Queen not huge fans of them. I mean, there was a famous article where they went and interviewed Freddie Mercury and had a really nice time, and then ran the interview with the headline, "Is this man a prat?" Which kind of upset him and upset his team. And I mean, those albums have come to retrospectively be appreciated, but certainly at the time they weren't particularly held in high esteem by the music press.
We all have our ups and downs, and we all have our limitations, and we all know that there are certain things you can't do. But I mean, I don't want some critic to tell me that.